blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory.
Been said that some have talked about Jesus spilling his blood. He didn't spill his blood. There was nothing accidental about it. He shed his blood. Amen. Palm Sunday marks one of the highest points in Jesus's popularity, bar none. But as we have discovered, with sinful man, polls are quick to change when people don't hold true convictions. In a matter of about 5 days, we will watch that crowd go from cheers to jeers. We watch the ones shouting Hosanna begin chanting, "Crucify him." And those who followed him closely hid their faces from him. In the course of about 5 days, Jesus went from triumph to trial. The scripture saw it coming, and they had told the story hundreds of years before it happened. There was nothing, absolutely nothing, that took God the Father by surprise, nor God the Son, for that matter. The Passion Week, as we are about to enter into, has filled with events. And if you attend Holy Week services, you'll be reminded of these things, such as the cleansing of the temple, the cursing of the fig tree, the woes of the to the Pharisees, the teachings and the healings there in the temple. But nothing had been anticipated from the foundation of the earth more than this week, because man would not be able to know God or His purpose on this globe without what was about to take place. Part of that week was to celebrate the Passover. That's why most of Israel had come together. Jesus had looked forward to this with great anticipation, and today we are going to observe both the Passover, which Jesus had looked forward to, as well as the Lord's Supper. Now, we do the Lord's Supper each quarter in accordance with the custom of the church, but this morning, we have designed the entire service around these two observances. We will have the Passover and the Lord's Supper because the two are inseparable. It's important to see that this Last Supper was instituted, or it was the Last Supper that instituted the Lord's Supper. And it was more than just a typical meal that Jesus had with his disciples. It was more than just a Last Supper together. It was a Passover meal. It was the annual feast of the Passover, and the meal was called the Seder, which means to set in order. Today, even today, devout Jews around the world will still celebrate this feast that we're going to see at the table as a memorial of God's deliverance of Israel out of Egypt. And without realizing it, they are commemorating the fulfillment of God's promise to not only deliver Israel from its physical bondage out of Egypt, but also to deliver all men from the bondage of sin and death by the slain lamb that died in their place. So this morning, I'd like to share the elements of the Seder by recognizing their fulfillment in Jesus Christ. Cindy and I had the privilege many times, and when we were in Memphis, when I was in seminary, attending a Brit Hadashah, which had observed the Messianic Seder, which gave Christian understanding to the elements. And that's what we want to do with you this morning. I'll be using a guide called the Haggadah, which means the telling, that reenacts the Passover meal, but provides the true understanding of the feast through its fulfillment in Jesus Christ. Come join me at the table of the Passover. It is believed in the upper room that was provided was used by Mary, the mother of John, and that he was probably present with them during that time. The Passover observance is going to be comprised of various rituals in various parts. The first one being the lighting of the candles. I've asked Cindy to light the candles and to have the blessing. First, she's going to give an introduction in Hebrew, and then she'll have the blessing in English.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has set us apart by his word and in whose name we light the festival lights.
Thank you. You'll also see on the table before me are four cups. These four cups have significance that come from Exodus chapter 6, verses 6 and 7. Where the scripture says, therefore say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. The first cup is called the cup of sanctification. And the scripture says, I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. This is the separating of Israel from Egypt. This is their sanctification. The second cup is called the cup of deliverance. And it is where he says, I will rescue you from their bondage, and the deliverance of Israel is going to be shared during the Passover. The third cup is called the cup of redemption. He says, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. And the final cup is the cup of praise. And the cup of praise says, I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. The cup of sanctification is the first one. After the lighting of the candles, they drink the first cup, and the group as a whole proclaims, "Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine." I wonder if you would just repeat that with me, would you? "Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine." Following the first cup would come the washing of the hands. They would have a basin in which their hands would be washed. On that particular night, there had been a discussion about who would wash the feet. So Jesus, taking the towel and the basin, rose from the table and began to wash the feet of the disciples. This is where that part of that story from the Gospels is shared with us. It should be noted at this time that Judas was still at the table. One of the things I've often wanted to see was a painting of Jesus looking up into the face of Judas, and the face that he has is a face of total rejection. There are so many times in which the Lord Jesus has kneeled to wash our feet, and we do not respond to him in the way that he is looking at us. Judas was there that night. There are other items on the table, and I'm going to show them to you on the screen. After he washed their feet, he then began to talk about the different things. And here are the other items that are on the table. And by the way, after we get done today, I'm going to invite you, if you would like, to just come on up and look at this table and to see the different elements. I've got a handout that will be there that will share with you what these elements are and what their meanings and significance are. But you can see the actual elements. And Cindy has even gone a step further. She's prepared pieces of matzah, and she has, in addition to what's on here, the churros that's on our little plate, she'll have a bowl of that if you'd like to try that, especially the kids. So that'll be available for you. But the other items on the table used to tell the story is, first of all, parsley. And then normally there is a shank bone of a lamb, chopped apples and nuts made into a sweet paste called a churros or a horoset, horseradish root, bitter herbs, a roasted egg, and in the center of the plate is a bowl of salt water. The very first thing that would have been done would be to take some of the parsley and to dip it into the salt water. And then they would take that. The parsley would be dipped to show that although the Passover is a feast that comes from the springtime, and therefore is when the earth is green and there is new life, that life in Egypt was a life of pain. It was a life of suffering. It was a life of tears. And that's why the salt water. Some have also suggested that the salt water represents the passing through of the Red Sea. And so they would take that and eat of the parsley. And the breaking and the hiding of the matzah. The matzah is the unleavened bread. You can find this in stores today. You will notice that it is there are three pieces, and that these three pieces, although they use three pieces, do not realize that what they're really saying is that this is, represents God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and it is the middle matzah that will be removed. And then it will be broken, wrapped in a cloth, and then hidden for the rest of the meal. The matzah is something that is also symbolic of the person of Christ. Not only is it the middle piece, that which represents the Son, God the Son, but you'll notice that it is also striped and pierced, just as our Savior was striped and his hands and feet were pierced. And just as the middle piece of bread of affliction is broken, the Messiah was afflicted and broken. One half is now called the Afikoman, and that means the coming one. It's wrapped in a white cloth, and just as the Lord's body was wrapped for burial, it's wrapped and then hidden, just as his body was hidden for 3 days in the tomb. Hidden for a time, As in Sunday school, we talked about this morning, in a little while, you will not see me. And that's what he's referring to. Hidden for a time, just as the Afikoman will return to complete our Passover Seder, so the sinless Messiah rose from the dead to ascend to heaven. Then comes a part of the service that involves children. And it's called the Four Questions. And I've asked Liberty Lynch to come, and she's going to come and share with us the Four Questions.
On all other nights, we eat bread or matzah. On this night, why do we eat only matzah? On all other nights, we eat all kinds of vegetable. On this night, why do we eat only bitter herbs? On all other nights, we do not dip our vegetables even once. On this night, why do we dip them twice? On all other nights, we eat our meals sitting or reclining. On this night, why do we eat only reclining?
Thank you. On all other nights, we eat the bread with leaven, but on Passover, we eat only the matzah, the unleavened bread. Why the unleavened bread? Well, for the Passover, as the children of Israel fled from Egypt, they did not have time for their bread to rise, so instead it became a piece that was hot. The hot desert sun had baked it flat. But even more than that, unleavened bread represents sinlessness, because leaven always represented sin. So the unleavened bread represents the body of Christ, which was a sinless sacrifice. The second question was, on all other nights we eat all kinds of vegetables, but on Passover we only eat marah, bitter herbs. Well, this was to remind them of how the bitter herbs on the matzah was to remember how bitter life was for the children of Israel in the land of Egypt. Now we're going to see this applied twice here in just a moment. On all other nights, it says, we do not dip our vegetables even once, but tonight we dip them twice. So after they dipped the matzah in the bitter herbs, then they dipped it in the haraseth, or this sweet mixture. Now, the reason for this, for sharing this, is that this was now to become bittersweet. The horseradish would be from the bitter herbs. The haraseth would be that which would be sweet. Jesus will then offer this piece of bread to Judas. You may remember from the scriptures from Mark chapter 14, as they sat and ate, Jesus said, "Assuredly, I say to you, one of you who eats with me will betray me." And they began to be sorrowful, and they said to him one by one, "Is it I?" And another, "Is it I?" He answered and said to him, "It's the one of the 12 who dips with me in the dish." And so that's what is done as part of the meal. It is John's gospel in the 13th chapter that tells us then that it is he to whom I shall give the piece of bread when I have dipped it. And having dipped the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. This was truly a bittersweet moment for Jesus. Bitter because he would be betrayed by a very close friend. It's the point that Jesus sends Judas on his way. He leaves the supper to go out into the night. He will not be present for the rest of the meal. And that's important. The fourth question, on all other nights we eat sitting or reclining, but tonight we eat reclining. They ate reclining in a position of both rest and readiness. Remember that the disciples were reclining and one was actually leaning back on Jesus' breast when he was asked by Peter, "Will you ask him who it is that is supposed to be betraying him?" So these are the four questions, and this is what we see that night taking place. The story of the Passover is then shared. And here, the story of the Exodus from Egypt is told for the generations to remember. This is why it was so important for the children. It was important for the children because the children needed to hear from generation to generation the mighty works of God. This was also the time for the second cup. And the second cup was the cup of deliverance. The second cup was poured, but before it was drank, they would dip their little finger in it. And I'm going to use this towel here now. And they would begin to drop out drops from the cup to show that the cup was no longer full, but that there had been sorrow. And this was based on the 10 plagues, so they would dip 10 times for blood, frogs, lice, flies, disease of the beasts, boils, hail and lightning, locusts, darkness, death. Then the Passover lamb. Now, normally there would be a lamb shank on the table, but I've been reminded that in Messianic congregations, they don't even put that there anymore because Jesus is our lamb. Jesus was the lamb that was slain. So before the second cup was drank, the leader would remind the group of these three things. He would talk first about the unleavened bread to remind them of the haste with which they departed from Egypt. He would talk about the bitter herbs, and then he would talk about the Passover lamb. And the lamb was to be without defect. It was to be male of the first year. They were to take some of the blood and apply it to the two sides and the top of the door frame of the entrance of the house. You're familiar with that from the story in Exodus chapter 12. And if you look at the door frame, you see the blood on both sides and there at the top, and that from the top dripping to the ground, you have the four places of where Jesus is crucified. His hands, his head, and his feet. Jesus is our lamb, and the blood is applied to our hearts and lives so that we might escape judgment. Now, the roasted egg that is on the table has been added to the Seder and is regarded to denote new birth and eternal life, since the shape of the egg shows no beginning and no end. And then a special blessing was pronounced after the second cup. After that, the meal would be eaten. And the meal was completed. There were going to be three more activities, and it was during this time that Jesus uses the elements of the Passover meal to give them new meaning and fulfillment in himself. You remember the piece of matzah that we wrapped and then hid? It was called the afikoman, and it was to be regarded as dessert. And that's why our scripture says, after the meal, he took the bread. He took that piece that had been hidden, and when he took it out, he reveals himself as the bread. The hidden matzah is revealed, and it is now brought out for dessert. It was this bread that Jesus took, and he said, and he used for the bread of the Lord's Supper. And he took, and what he said was found in Luke chapter 22:19. He took the bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave to them, and he said, "This is my body." That which had been given for them and hidden for the duration of the meal has now been revealed and has been brought up. He says, "This is my body, which has been given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The significance of this piece was that it represented his body that had been hidden for 3 days and now brought forth. The body that had been given was now being shared with those who believe. And if you realize now, Judas is not at the table. Judas has left. He's gone out into the night. And so he was not present for the instituting of the Lord's Supper. Then he took the third cup. And the third cup was called the cup of redemption. He took the third cup and the cup associated with redemption, and he applied his own blood to the meaning of this cup. Once again, reading from Luke chapter 22, verse 20 says, "Likewise also he took the cup after the supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you.'" Jesus was saying that his blood would be shed to redeem man from his sin. Out of the Passover, out of the picture of the deliverance from Egypt, Jesus draws from those elements that which was known to his men very clearly and gives them new meaning. These two elements were now part of a traditional observance. They weren't just the elements that were handy at the table. It was purposely planned. And Jesus had been waiting a long time to share this time with his disciples. I think it helps to see the Lord's Supper as it was first observed, that we get the full meaning of what Jesus accomplished in his sacrifice before we go to the table of the Lord. By the way, there's one more cup, you may have noticed. And this fourth cup was called the cup of praise. It's not sure whether Jesus and his disciples even took this cup, because in Matthew's gospel, he makes this statement: "But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Many believe that this fourth cup, this cup of praise, is being reserved for us when we get to heaven. This is going to be the cup we share with him at the marriage supper of the Lamb, which is why he didn't drink it that night. And he says, "I won't drink it until I drink it anew with you in the kingdom of heaven." But regardless of that fourth cup, they did sing the Hallel. And the Hallel, by the way, is comprised of six psalms that appear from Psalm 113 to 118. I found this to be absolutely fascinating, because we have been in services where we said when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the night, and we always sang Amazing Grace. They didn't sing Amazing Grace. They sung the Hallel, which, by the way, is where we get the word hallelujah from. It means praise. And we don't have time to go through all six chapters, but I do want to share with you four verses from chapter 116, because I think they're significant. You see, in chapter 116, verse 12 says, "What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me?" The following verse, verse 13, is, "I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord." Verse 14 says, "I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all of his people." And verse 15 is a verse that we've heard many times at funerals. But bear in mind, Jesus is singing this with his disciples on his way to the Mount of Olives. He simply says to them, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." Jesus left the upper room singing about his own death, taking up the cup of salvation, a cup that he would find himself praying about just hours later. But the psalmist would remind him how precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints, how much more the death of his son. As we come to this portion tonight, or this morning, I want to ask you a question. Jesus surrendered his all to die upon a cross for you and for me. Have you given your all to him? Have you given your life to him as your Lord, as your Savior? We look at the Passover and we see it being fulfilled in this sacrifice that Jesus is about to do. In a moment, we're going to take of the Lord's Supper to remind us of what he did. But between those two points, between these two tables, was a cross. And on that cross, Jesus died for your sins and for my sins. And if you have waited in your life for an appropriate time, I can think of no more appropriate time than the present. The scripture says that now is the appointed time. Now is the day of salvation. If you've never given your heart and life to Jesus Christ, may I appeal to you to do that today? Reading from the book of 1 Corinthians in chapter 11, Paul shares these words: "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, He broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
As we're distributing the bread, you may sing along with me as you feel led. We're going to do a medley of some songs to help keep us focused on this special time.
Taking the bread, he gave thanks. Father, we do give thanks today for the body of Christ that was given for us, the life that was shared. And Father, we just take this sacrifice now, and as we take of this bread, we remember that which was done upon the cross for us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. In the same manner also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me."
Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood?
In like manner, he took the cup. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we thank you for the precious blood that cleanses us from all unrighteousness. We thank you that as your life blood poured out, that it was being poured out for us, that, Lord, it was being received by us. May we now take of this life and live the life that you have designed for us. Live a life abundant, a life that knows you. And we ask this in Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Take, drink all of it. Paul then adds these words as a reminder to us and as an encouragement. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes, because he is coming again. Amen. Thank you for being a part of this morning. As we close in prayer once again, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me. Father, we thank you for loving us the way you do.